Great.
It wasn't on
the
picture.
She was in there
right there.
Yeah. Your brother?
It's kind of funny because like we saw the last 24 hours, but
yeah,
we just picked up and
like, I forgot.
So, like,
no,
forgot.
Make sure you pay attention to us. We spent the whole time. If you just did just for your Mexican
food, you know. This is James.
We already met.
No,
how do you know I'm partial to lemon tech?
I will not do
lemon tech. I do.
This is my first. Yeah.
Well, you're a deformity.
Where did they find this guy?
We were trying to get some work done today. We didn't play.
Oh boy. So I missed another show. It's a show about a British comedian. Like I wrote in my comments, I'm gonna cry.
I know. Oh, you're gonna cry.
No, but somebody has.
Wow. Like these.
Prudish show.
I'm never heard of it. Yeah, but don't just ignore us. It's like a whole day with
you. You and your Mexican partner. So this is AstroPerm.
AstroPerm.
Nice to meet you. We did an opera together.
We did.
Well, you also did. Everybody does an opera.
Everyone does.
I can do it. I didn't see that in person, so I don't know. Oh, yeah. I know a character in a book that I'm reading dies because I opened it. I'm like, hey, can't read this book anymore, and I put back myself until I submit.
It does ruin everything.
I like seeing if something's happening in the next 7 days.
I ended up giving her one.
What?
No.
But yeah, I was totally harassing her. I'm like, oh, I'm running to see a show. I'm like, I love the survey. You don't love me like that, can you? No, like, we didn't change the topic.
I don't know who you're talking
to. Well, it was great.
Okay, who are you talking to?
We didn't know what the problem was. So what happened was somebody who did take it very seriously, their group went out to the dollar store and bought a bag of candy to replace people's candy.
To win the candy, they bought people's candy.
It's all day. You get hit out of the equation, they take it.
He like made eyes.
He made eyes.
Yeah, he's like, pick a burn. I know how you want to do it. So I looked up and we're like, yeah, like, could you won last? Could you won the last time challenge?
And then talk.
You're not allowed to read other things.
No.
You
I'm not reading.
Caught up with me where I am.
I am caught up. I read 167 pages.
Well, then I'm 172 pages ahead. I read like a piece. Oh, it's Clay.
Oh,
many Clays. Yeah,
got it for a buck.
No.
What's the Clay?
What century was it?
1920.
Oh, 1920. Yeah. Oh, yeah. 1960.
Yeah, he told me.
I haven't read it. No,
at all. My daddy used to say that they were just jealous because I had this really awesome hat I got to wear all the time. I even wore it to bed. I loved that hat. My daddy gave it to me. He wrote my name in it and everything. He gave it to me because I remember the day that he gave it to me. My mom called me in the kitchen because my daddy needed to talk to me. Sit down, Daniel. I never really noticed till then how thin he'd gotten. His pajamas had grown bigger on him over the last year.
Son, there's some good people coming here from the hospital to take me away so I can get better.
It was kind of cool because every day my daddy was sounding more and more like Darth Vader from the movies.
Daniel, it's the only way, son.
But I still didn't like it. Then he reached under the table, and when his hands came back up, in them was a big shiny box with a bow on it. He gave it to me and said it would give me courage while he was away. I opened it up, and inside was an army beret, just like my grandpa's in the pictures from the war. I wanted to be a soldier like grandpa. He was good. People liked him. Nobody made fun of grandpa. No one. You know, he's a very good present. Later, the hospital came and got him, and I started to get scared.
Now, don't worry, Daniel. You can come visit anytime you want.
And then he was gone. I got to see him every day after school and Sunday before church in the hospital, and it was really fun because we would talk and we would play, and he'd tell me such funny stories. Every day I would say to him, I'd say, Daddy, how do you feel today? And he'd say,
I feel as strong as an ox.
And then he'd rub the top of my head with his hand. I really liked that. I knew his eyes were lying to me when he stopped rubbing my head because he was too weak to lift his arm. I used to do it for him, though. I'd lift his arm and I'd hold his hand on top of my head and move my head around in a circle so he could keep doing it. He really liked that. One morning I showed up and his bed was empty. I wore that hat he gave me for 2 years straight after. I'm sorry, what was the question? School? I hated school. I hated it. It sucked. I remember in the fourth grade during recess, I was playing in the schoolyard, just me and my G.I. Joes having a great time, and then this big kid, this big fatso, Hoger Ritter, he took my hat while his buddies cornered me behind the tool shed. Then it started. Calling me names, things like retardo, crybaby, mama's boy, stuff like that. They wouldn't get off my back. I tried to slip past them to get my hat, but they kept pushing me hard into the brick wall. I started screaming at them, give it back, it's my hat, it's mine. They just all laughed at me, started spitting on me, laughing as they chanted, come on, titty boy, cry for your hat if you want it back, cry for your hat if you want it back, cry for your hat if you want it back. I haven't done anything to anyone, it wasn't my fault, whatever it was. And then Hoker punched me in the stomach, I fell down, and I did. I did start crying, just crying up the door. They cheered, the school bell rang, and then everybody laughed. When I found my hat, it was inside of a garbage can. I picked it up and it was full of that spit. No, I didn't go back to school. I went home and I washed my hat in our kitchen sink. No, I didn't tell my mom. I was the man of the house now. Next? The next morning I got up early. I don't even think I slept. Put on my hat, it was still a little wet. Then rushed to the bridge over Meadows Creek with my grandpa's iron trench bag in my backpack, and I waited for Hoger. That greasy-haired, cross-eyed, fat piece of shit. I hid under the bridge, and I waited, and waited. Soon he was walking on the wooden bridge right above me. I watched the rotting beams buckle a little bit under his weight. After he passed, I climbed up on the other side. I unpacked the spade and began sneaking up to him as he crossed the meadow towards our school. My heart was pounding louder and louder. I got scared that he'd hear it. But he didn't. When I was close enough, I rose the spade up high and whack. He wasn't so tough, not so tough at all. You know, he was the big baby, not me. You know, he peed himself, right before he died. Big baby. They sent me here after that, but nobody ever made fun of me again. I think my dad would have been proud. How do I feel about what I did to Holger? I feel that he shouldn't have touched my hat. It was mine.
She's got a way about her. I don't know what it is, but I know that I can't live without her. She's got a way of pleasing. I don't know why it is, but there doesn't have to be a reason anyway. She's got a smile that heals me. I don't know why it is, but I have to laugh when she reveals me. She's got a way of talking. I don't know why it is.
I'm sorry, did you? No, you. Okay, sure, thank you. You can go next. Great, thanks. Hi, my name is Michael. Thank you. This is my first time, so I'm just gonna dive right in. Well, I was in love. I was in love with Shelley. Shelley and I lived together for 3 years, 6 months, and 27 days. And those were the best 1,271 days of my life. The hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life was say goodbye to my sweet, beloved Shelley. I'll never forget the events of our 1,271st night together. I arrived home a little later than usual from the office. It was quarter end, performance bonuses were in, and I performed exceedingly well. I was working on Wall Street. It was great times back then. So anyways, I arrived home a little later than usual, and I tiptoed into the bedroom just to see if Shelley was awake when I found her. She'd stopped breathing. Friends of ours used to come over to the penthouse and say, "My God, Michael, Shelley's getting so fucking fat." Well, she was. I never saw it. She was beautiful to me, absolutely beautiful. I did blame myself at first. I kept buying more food. The more I bought, the more she ate, but the happier she seemed, and Shelley's happiness was always my top priority. I stood there for an hour or so, just listening to the gentle hum of her water filter, watching her angelic apple-shaped body bobbing up and down, breaking the water's surface, feeling pain, nothing but unspeakable pain. Then I drifted out onto the balcony. I climbed the railings, preparing to join my sweet Shelley in death, when the blinking of my digital alarm clock caught my attention and silenced my moans. It was blinking at 12 o'clock, it's 12 o'clock, it's 12 o'clock. I climbed back in, and I telephoned my superintendent, and when he confessed, numbed my pain. Apparently that blue-collared bastard had turned off the power for 10 hours earlier that day to fix the boiler or something stupid like that. I guess I forgot to tell you, buddy. Sorry about your goldfish, buddy. As I put down the phone's receiver, it became icy clear to me. I had not killed my golden fin lover. No, it was my super. He murdered my goldfish, my one true love, my sweet beloved Shelley. I became blinded by visions of Shelley's cruel suffering, her suffocation. Nothing but blue could I see. Do you understand? It was at that point that I realized that my body had been taken over by a supernatural alien force, and its name was Voltar, galactic warrior spirit of vengeance. Voltar then commanded me to pick up the tattletale alarm clock, and I did. And together we stormed down the 12 flights of stairs to my superintendent's front door. Voltar commanded me to kick it in. And I did. And there was my superintendent sitting down to a late night snack. Fish and chips, Voltar! Obviously mocking my loss. So Voltar grabbed him by the throat and began beating him with the evidence of his vile crime as I thundered in a voice that was not my own. It's 12 o'clock, buddy! It's 12 o'clock, buddy! It's 12 o'clock, buddy! And with the deed done,
Baltar relinquished control of my facets and ascended back up into the cosmos from whence he came. Leaving I alone to explain to the authorities what had tragically transpired that evening. Well, my superintendent lived, yay. I spent the next 7 years inside of Bellevue Psychiatric Hospital. It was nice. I was released 27 days ago, and part of my rehabilitation back in society, they'd gotten me a job. I now run the midnight, late night drive-through window of Burger World. It's very challenging work. Yeah. Well, my doctors say that if I just allow myself to experience closure with the loss of Shelley, that I'll be able to move on and love again. Love again. Oh, you guys should come to her funeral. It's next week at SeaWorld. There's going to be jumping dolphins and fireworks. I have a burning funeral pyre, and the entire original cast of Baywatch is going to be on there. Pamela Anderson's even coming. She's an animal lover. She understands what I'm going through. She's a really, really nice lady. Yeah. Now, what does that have to do with all of you being alcoholics? I'm not quite sure, but I couldn't find my group. It's a very large facility. Everyone else was getting up and sharing, and it seemed to do them a lot of good, and you know what? I do feel much better. Thank you. It does feel good. Hey, don't drink! Alcohol is bad! And I'll see you at the funeral next Saturday, 2 p.m., SeaWorld.
Posted together at Camp Leatherneck in the Helmand province of Afghanistan. And on June 27, 2009, we were part of a fire team that was tasked to investigate an object that appeared about 45 miles outside the base on the Barren Highway. It was considered friendly territory, very low-risk mission, and the brass needed eyes on the ground because the orbiting surveillance satellite, the zoom lens, was malfunctioning. So Rusty, myself, and two other privates, we crammed into a Hummer and then hit the road. I recall that drive being very unpleasant. Rusty sang the whole way up in falsetto. After about an hour, we arrived on target, and Rusty ended his renditions, thank God. And we observed what appeared to be a wagon abandoned on the side of the road. Rusty and myself, we got out and investigated and concluded, yes, it was a wagon. We took some photos for HQ and turned back towards the Hummer, and that's when it exploded in a ball of fire and flame. The shockwave from the explosion launched us about 12 feet in the air, and when we finally gained our bearings again, we found ourselves surrounded by about 30 armed men calling themselves the Sons of Allah. We were then stripped naked, dressed in peasant clothing, and then secretly camelbacked via across the desert for 3 weeks up into the eastern mountain ranges that border Pakistan, where we were stuck into a dank cave. The cave was most unpleasant. It wasn't so much the starvation or the dehydration, the light deprivation or the heat or the cold, it was the fact that the cave was highly acoustic. Something that Rusty enjoyed very much. I did not. Well, the leader of the Sons of Allah was this peculiar little feller with one eye named Hassim. See, Hassim had got it into his head that he captured some targets of real interest, that we held top secret military secrets, which was quite baffling to Rusty and myself, seeing how we were both privates and knew little beyond the end of a rifle. Yet, Hassim persisted in his beliefs. So, pretty near every day, Rusty and myself were taken from the cave, tied up, and brought to Hassim's tent where he would interrogate us. It was very unpleasant. Hassim took to us, I will say, in the manner in which excited children do piñatas at birthday parties. Well, when we weren't being interrogated, Hassim would have us locked up often in these two wooden crates, which laid side by side, about the size of a refrigerator on its side, about 6-7 holes on either panel to allow ventilation so it wouldn't expire, and so they could feed in a tube to feed us honey water to keep us alive. It was very unpleasant, very cramped, very tight in there. That wasn't so bad, though. At night, we had a nice view of the stars when we were in those boxes versus the cave. And Rusty and myself would talk all night sometimes, got to know each other really well. He had some pretty interesting ideas on the world, that's for sure, given a chance. I remember one stretch that lasted 11 days where we were in those boxes. After 9 days, I broke down, started crying, weeping, just hoping they'd let me die, but Rusty would have none. You know what he said to me? He said, Bobby, if you give up and die, I'm going to kill you. He was real funny like that, I'll kill you. Yeah. And then he did this really remarkable thing. He managed to find two holes between our boxes, which lined up, and he snaked one of his thick fingers through it, and he said, now, Bobby, you feel around there for my finger, and you hold on to it for as long as you want, because I ain't going anywhere. I ain't going anywhere. It's real funny like that. So I did. I felt around there for Rusty's finger. I felt around there for Rusty's finger, and I held on to it every day and night from then on, and every time they locked us in those boxes. He was a real good friend. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I remember after about 11 months of Hassim's hospitality, Rusty had had enough. One morning in the cave, he said to me, I ain't gonna answer no more questions to that little feller. I've had enough. I ain't nobody's plaything, he said. You know, Rusty was stubborn. It's true, Mrs. Howard. He was very stubborn, thick-headed like a mule. I tried to talk him out of it, but he'd have none of it. So the next time that we were brought in for 20 questions and Rusty didn't say a word, well, Hassim just lit into him with a vengeance, but Rusty stayed silent. Now, this interrogation went on for about 9 hours. It was very unpleasant to watch, but through it all, Rusty stayed silent. I could read his eyes, though, so full of pain and rage and torment, but most of all, the resolve of a man resolved to keep his word to himself. Well, by the time sunset came, the game was over. That's how 20 questions always ended, because them fellers over there, they have to go and say their prayers to the setting sun, is the custom of those people. So Hassim had to leave the tent, all crestfallen, knowing he'd lost. Now, that gave us a few minutes together. I remember I was tied up on the floor and gagged because I started screaming hours prior and they didn't want to hear me anymore. So I was just lying there watching Rusty, and he looked pretty bad, you know, he'd been butchered pretty bad, but he was still alive. And after about 2 minutes, he finally lifted his head after a few failed attempts. And then he looked at me, and his eyes got all big and blue and calm, and he took a big breath, and he also grinned, you know, like the type of grin he used to do when we were kids. I was about to catch hell for something he did and blame me for. And then he took a breath and he said, you know what he said? His last words on this planet were, he said, Bobby, you remember to play me AG. And then he died, just like that. Yeah, he's such a great man. Yeah, so I'm going to do that for now. I'm going to play AG on this here harmonica, and I hope Rusty hears it and rides in sweet melody on up into heaven. This one's for you, Rusty, my best friend.
That's life, that's what all the people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that thing. When I'm back on top of June, I said that's life. And as funny as it may seem, some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. Cause this fine old world, it keeps spinning around. I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself flat on my face, I pick myself.
Peekaboo, I see you, Joey. You know, my God, I used to love to play that game, man. Yeah. Joey. Listen, kid, I see things, I hear things, and I know things, and you, my little friend, are way up shit creek with him, pal. Yeah. So let me ask you. You got any idea why you would be tied up in my basement right now, kid? No? Oh, well, allow me to play Prometheus to your human ignorance and provide some illumination for you. You know what, not for nothing, you kind of remind me of an old friend of mine, yeah. You look just like Aldo Carboni, that's right, you look like my old friend Aldo Carboni. Yeah, he was a real funny looking kid, kind of like you. Now, Joey, permit me to tell you a little story about my old friend Aldo. Okay, Now you listen very, very carefully. Now, when I was a little boy, growing up in the slums of Chicago, my mother, she was quite a lady, my mother, she set aside a little money from each of her welfare checks. And over a certain period of time, she saved up enough money to buy me a big red fire truck for my 7th birthday. It was a big fire truck with a water pump, a ladder, and everything. It even came with one of the plastic fire chief hats. Now, I love that truck, and I played with it every single day. Now, one day, my best friend, Aldo Carboni, asked if he could borrow my truck. We agreed he'd return it to me in 3 days. 3 days later, no truck. He said he'd have it by the end of the week. He did, but the ladder was missing. My ladder, my toy white ladder, my fucking ladder! Aldo handed me my truck and he said, "I'm sorry about the ladder, Frankie." I took my truck and I said, "Don't worry about it, Aldo, that's all right. Don't worry about it." He smiled at me, I smiled at him, and then we went off and played together. Now, about a week later, while Aldo was at school and I was, I don't know, homesick, Aldo's house burnt down. Yeah, grandmother and all, poor fucking kiddies. She was all he had in the world. Now she was gone for 2 fucking Chris. Poor fucking kid. Right now, at the funeral for Aldo's granny, I gave him my fire twice. And he thanked me. He fucking thanked me, then went off to live in an orphanage alone and penniless for the rest of his life. But, goodbye, Aldo. He got to keep my twock. Yeah. Now, let me ask you a question and give me a twin answer. Is the word asshole typed across my forehead? Oh, you think that's funny? I see a little hint of a smile coming across your little tear-stained face. Hey, I'm not fucking around here! Is the word asshole typed across my fucking forehead? What, Joey? No? No? No! Good answer, that's right. If it was, I would have noticed it this morning when I shaved. Ba-da-ba! Good answer, good. See, we're both operating in the same universe here. You're not off on some other fucking non-known dimension. That's good. So, Joey, you figure it out yet? Do you know why you're here? No? Okay, I'll play along. Now, let me ask you another question, then. Did you read the newspaper this morning? Oh, yeah? Well, that's nice. But I didn't because you didn't make your frickin' delivery. Joey, where's my newspaper? What do you mean you don't know? It's your job to know. You're a paper boy. You're my paper boy. Am I right or am I right here? Especially when, once again, my newspaper did not arrive this morning. 3 days in a row, no newspaper. I'm sitting on a john, I'm reading the back of shampoo bottles. Nothing's coming out. I'm up here, kid, because of you. On top of that, I get to track you down, rent a van, stop at the hardware store, buy a shovel, an axe, all the way from New Jersey. You really fucked my day up here. Oh, you think I should have just went and bought another newspaper? Well, I have a subscription for home delivery! This is about principles, kid. Principles, what this great country was founded on! Look, you can tell me. I'm not gonna get mad. Come on, you can tell me. Who did you give my newspaper to? Huh? Who did you give it to? Come on. Did you give it to the cops, the Fed, the DA, the CIA? Who, you little shit? Who? Oh, Ryan! If you delivered it, I would have been there this morning when I woke up, you lying mother. Yeah, I'm sorry, Adele. I'm just a little stressed right now. My trial starts next week. DA's got like 1,000 witnesses lined up to go, yeah, that's the guy, that's the guy. I mean, froze some of my assets, took my passport. Some of my own people turning on me. Too much talk going on. Look, Joey, I like you, I really do. You've been a great paper boy for years, you have. You know, you don't walk on my grass, you don't eat my house on Halloween, and every year your mother gives me a fruit cake at Christmas, green cherries and nuts. Yeah, I hate that shit, but it's a thought that counts. You come from a nice family. Yeah, family is one of nature's masterpieces. You know, the poet George Santayana said that, yeah. Yeah, you have a nice family, a real nice family there, kid. So out of respect for your family, I'm gonna ask one more time. One more time! And then if you don't tell me what I want to hear, I'm just going to say, hey, don't worry about it. You can keep it, because we're friends, right, Joey? Good friends. Joey, look at me. Where's my fire truck? Oh, wow, I didn't think that was going to happen. Oh, shit. I thought you were all the vermin in there. Oh, my God. Come back from the grave. Oh, my God. Just wrote my newspaper. You know, I just want to sit on the john, kick a crap, feel like a normal person. Those bastards are trying to think of everything else. They can't have that. So you're 12, huh? Well, I remember 12, so you start to turn nuts now? Yeah. Hey, Joey, you okay? You look a little pale. Scared? You can tell me.
Yeah.
I'm scared too, you know. If you want to go home, you probably miss your mom. Yeah, I miss my mom too. She was a really nice lady. She really loved me. I should have never given away that fire truck, you know? It was so cool! Woo woo! Look at me here. Maybe going to prison is a good idea. Toughen me up a little bit. I'm getting soft. So if I kill you, how long does it take for another kid to take your route? Yeah, I don't know either. By then, my blue eyes will be brown, if you know what I mean. So you and I, we gotta cut ourselves a deal here, okay? All right, two conditions. First, tomorrow morning, I wake up, boom, paper! Two, you can't tell anyone about this little arrangement, all right? Not the Fed, not the DA, not the cops, and not your mother. I made a decision, I'm gonna beat this rap. And if I don't get a Christmas cake this Christmas, green cherries and nuts, I'm gonna assume that you blow up your little mouth and not to come looking for you. And you're gonna have a lot more in common with my friend Aldo than his Picasso looks, capiche?
Red roses too. I've seen in blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds. The bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do? They really say, I love you. I hear babies cry.
Well, I think this video camera's recording. The wee little red light's on. That's good. God bless me. Oh, God. Don't ever get old. Oh, it's about as much fun as a circumcision by a blind man. Well, Wendy May Jones, as you can see, this is your father, Darcy Piercy Gopins. And by now you've probably found out that I'm dead. It's all old news. But wait a minute. If you haven't, you'll be a good girl and send someone over to the house before I start to stink the whole place up. Now, this videotape is for your eyes, and your eyes only. To hell with your brother. Not one word from him in 2 years. 2 years, not one goddamn word. Oh, I remember what he told me that day, though, after your mother's funeral. Go to hell, father. You're a heartless drunk. You didn't deserve mother's love. Go to hell, old man. Yeah, well, you first, you little coward. Well. Well, the story is, he says, I'm dying. Doctor says, I'm gonna die, so I'm dying, so I guess I'm just dying. I guess. Life. Who needs it anyways? Not me, it's all memories now, mostly memories. I don't need it, that's for sure. Besides, ever since Wayne Gretzky retired, hockey has sucked without the great one. Suppose I'll miss a few things, though. You know, a good hot dog with ketchup. Good cigar. Good scotch. Halloween.
Yeah.
That's my favorite day of the year. Halloween, all them ugly-faced children running around, laughter and screams. Yeah, you and your brother would get so worked up. My own little band of ugly-faced children running around. It's not like your brother ever needed a mask, though. Ugly, silly child, never figured that out. Heard a mask would have been an improvement for him year-round. Come to think of it, your mother hated Halloween. Yeah, she was a poop. A poop her whole life. Isn't a goddamn antichrist of fun she was. Come to think of it, your mother was an awful wife. Awful homemaker, awful cook. Like eating dirt in your mother's cooking of the dead. Truth. Sometimes we lie to those we love to make them happy. Oh yes, Izzy, I'd love another slice of your dirt pie. Keep it covered, lovey.
Jesus, no wonder I'm dying.
Your mother was an awful wife.
But one hell of a woman.
And I miss her. So many memories of her, you know. So many. It's all memories now. I don't need it, that's for sure. Speaking of ugly, I think the ugliest faces I ever did see were in Poland. October 25, 1945, inside of Auschwitz. I remember when my squad entered through the iron gates of Auschwitz, all the Nazis were gone. They liberated the place with a slingshot. Ashes were everywhere. Part of the air, this long, thick, speckled blanket beneath our feet. The smell would hit you like a wall, all sweet and foul, like rotting apples. First we came across the prisoners, you know. Men and women, thin, sickly, shaved, bald, bloated bodies. Poor souls. Then we came across all the wee ones, you know, little boys and girls, 100 of them, all huddled together for work, all ragged and buggy-eyed. Yeah. Soon enough, the Red Cross stepped in, though, you know, set up hospital tents almost immediately, caring for them, old people. The Red Cross, they're good people, you know. Good people. Well, look, Wendy, understand what I did for them children. You have to understand war. Not a lot of opportunities for compassion in war. It's a bloody business, so. A few nights later was Halloween, so I decided I would steal a box of U.S. Army chocolate rations from the supply depot, you know, Hershey bars, actually. They used to give them to us with our cigarettes. And then I painted up my face all funny like a clown, you know. And then I snuck into one of them children hospital tents and popped up and sang out, trick or treat there, little wee ones. Trick or treat. And I started handing out them candy bars. And They didn't understand a single word of what I was saying. They all smiled, you know. So the stronger ones, they even laughed out loud. Yeah, we have ourselves a great little Halloween party, a great party. Yeah. I had my favorite too, you know. This wee little Polish girl, about 5 years old. So tiny, so thin. She had red hair all cropped short, with huge walnut eyes. Nikita, I think that's what she got her name was Nikita. Yeah. Poor dear, you know, she was so weak she couldn't chew the chocolate I brought her, but I remedied that, you see. I would break off a square of that Hershey's chocolate, and I'd stick it here on my lower lip. Like this. And then it would soften, and then she would open up her mouth, and I would pop it in, and the chocolate would keep spreading out over her taste buds, and her eyes would just light up like a birthday cake, just a blazing, you know. There you go, little bird. There you go. I called her my little bird, my sweet little Nicky bird. Yeah. There you go. You eat there. Grow strong. Yeah. She had 3 whole candy bars that way.
Yeah. Well,
soon enough, the Red Cross nurses showed up with the MPs, crushed my party, gave me all smoke in hell. Said I was a cruel man. Cruel man for what you've done, Darcy. Cruel. Took 4 of them to drag me from my baby bird's bedside. They punished me for my thievery, put me on ditch duty. Bastards. Truth. I didn't know. I understood, though, a few days later why they were all so mad at me, you know. Apparently all the children in that tent landing, just that one tent, they were all marked for death. Couldn't digest anymore. Oh, yes. I didn't know. I understood, though, as part of my punishment, I was ordered to start removing the corpses of the wee children as they died off one by one. All 67 of them, I carried them from that tent and laid them into my freshly dug ditches. Even my sweet little Nicky bird, I plucked her from her nest, carried her in my arms, and laid her in my ditch. Never again to see them eyes light up like a birthday cake ever again. Yeah, dull memories now. Mostly memories I don't need it, that's for sure. Yeah. Well, maybe I'll see my little Nicky bird tonight, flying high above this hard world. Yeah, that would be heaven, you know. Have her as my guide into oblivion. Look. I just want you to know that in life, I always tried to do what I thought was right. It just turns out what I thought was right always turned out to be the most wrong. For that, I'm sorry. Well, I suppose I should get this in the post. Get some rest. Need some sleep for my flying lessons later. Listen, child, I want you to do something for your old man here. I want you to remember me on Halloween, and that your brother's only half right about me being a heartless drunk. Well, I guess this is goodbye. I'll tell your mother you miss her cooking. God bless you, Kay. Trick or treat.
These last beaches.
myself, I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole me a man's soul away. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Pleased to meet you. Hope you can't smile.
It's second, Your Honor.
Oh, God.
Your Honor, ladies and gentlemen of the court, thank you for allowing me to speak before my sentencing. Your Honor, this is my defense. I had a bad day. Now, wait a minute. Look, I had a bad day. We've all had bad days. But mine was the Genghis Khan of all bad days. It was hot. Mid-July, you gotta understand, I drive a crazy clown ice cream truck now. And that day, not a single man, woman, or child in a 50-mile radius bought one, two, to three scoop of ice cream from me. Not one the whole damn day. It's degrading what I gotta do to make a living nowadays. You know what my boss makes me wear? I'll show you what he makes me wear. Now, this is supposed to make me look more friendly. Now do I look more friendly? For the day in question, I give up on selling ice cream. I say, you know, I'm going to drive to the new Veterans Legion, the one on Route 66, for their grand opening. I'm a bona fide member and then some. Yeah, so I drive over, I park my truck, I mosey on in, take a little look around. Well, it looks nice, looks real nice. I saddle up to the bar, order myself a cool, refreshing beer. Now, some prick bartender who's probably home from Princeton who's been studying passive aggressiveness hands me a beer warmer than my asshole after eating about a dozen jalapeno peppers washed down by a fifth of tequila. The little prick says $4.50. I say, excuse me, son, but this beer's warm. Little prick says $4.50. I say, excuse me, son, but this beer is warm. He says, so? And I say, well, why don't you hop up like a bunny hop back there and get me another one cold now? So about a year later, he comes hopping back. I take it, I taste it. Now this one's warmer than the last, Your Honor. I can feel the bottle burning in my palm. It's like drinking Tabasco sauce right out of the bottle. That's how volcanic it felt. Now I'm about to snap like a cinnamon stick on this kid. But he cuts me off with, hey man, if you don't like it here, you can go somewhere else. They're all like that. Then he tweaks my nose and walks away. I'm about to open up a huge can of whoop-ass on this kid, but I don't. I just place the offensive bottle on the bar and I quietly back away. Now I'm driving home, and I start thinking of all the shit I did for this country, you know, in the name of freedom and democracy. But it's an hour later, and I understand I'm back at the Legion, but this time I'm packing both my 45s. You see, this has gone past being personal. It's now an issue of national security, top-level clearance. So I secure the perimeter, I recon the bar, I open up all the beer fridges, and all the beers are piss warm! Now I check them fridges, and they're all made in some piss-ass third-world country where tree bark for clothes and worship to some kind of monkey god. Now tell me, please, what do these people know about keeping beer cold? Not a damn thing, that's right. Oh, free trade, another great idea, thank you very much, Congress! You know, I could tell that the old-timers understood. They had a look of real deep affection for me as I barricaded the doors and windows and held the bar staff hostage for 17 hours until the new American-made beer fridges had arrived! Hoorah! You see, by serving piss-warm beer to the men and women who risked their lives for this country's freedom, you insult me, them, and all my brothers and sisters that lie deep within the soils of foreign countries. They paid the ultimate price for your freedom. It is them, the veterans, that we honor our toast as we raise our cold beers high and praise the dead, and that we got to know them at least a short while, that we have lived to keep the memory of their brave deeds alive in our toast. Hallelujah! God bless America! I love being American, home of the brave, land of the free, stars and stripes forever, Your Honor! No, I'm not done, you ungrateful cocksucker. You know what? You can decide to lock me up.
as you want. Because I know somewhere out there there's a group of America's finest holding cool beers high and honoring the bravery of the dead. And now my name is accounted among theirs. You know, you should be giving me a medal or a parade or some shit. Yeah. That's it. The defense rests. Thank you very much, Your Honor. Oh, wait a minute. You know what? I forgot to mention. I'm real sorry about shooting that little pussy bartender in both his palms. Every war has its casualties, right? Right.